Congressman, are you seeing more of your local officials and other groups going for this Robredo Duterte tandem?
Yeah, I think so. Because essentially, what is the fundamental basis? There are at least 17 provinces where they both won. I mean, Duterte and VP Lenny, Agusan del Norte, Nidagat, Southern Leyte, Cebu, Bohol, Lano del Norte, Lano del Sur, Misamis Oriental, Bukidnon, Maguindanao, Tawi-Tawi, Basilan, Batangas, Zamboanga, Sibugay, Zamboanga City, Lapu-Lapu City. That's 11 million voters.
Mm-hmm.
So right now we have about 7 or openly declared, but I know of at least 20, additional 20 will soon come out for Lenny's
hour. Is that right? So you have this on solid, not just information, but a commitment from these local government officials? I mean, considering that you have former Senator Marcos leading in the survey by a mile.
Yeah, but of course there are local preferences.
Mm.
And generally, I think the fundamental basis is that these provinces that I've talked about, they voted for Lenny as vice president.
Mm-mm.
And they voted for Duterte as president. So we start to draw the empirical preference from that. So it's just that it's like our pool or it's like our universe. And thus far, we've been drawing open support from many political leaders there.
Mm-mm. I wanted to ask you about the Bicol region. There are 3.9 million registered voters. That's as of October 2021. Is this figure still correct?
Yes.
Okay. And in the Bicol region, of the 3.9 million voters, Congressman, how many do you believe can the Bicol region deliver for Robredo? Because you do have some LGUs that are not openly supporting her.
The LGUs, yes, but the people will. I can almost describe the Bicol region as being in a tunnel vision. In fact, there's a very active cancel culture there. If you don't go for Lenny, you're either boycotted your restaurant. So I think it's like very aggressive campaign for Lenny there. So I think she will hit 90% there.
Mm-mm. You're saying that's interesting. There's cancel culture in the Bicol region that if you don't go for Lenny, that's what you're saying, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. So and I think the political fortunes of those LGUs, you watch me, how they will eventually turn out.
Okay. So are you saying even Camarines Norte, Catanduanes, Masbate, Camarines Sur?
Well, Camarines Sur, I will expect that. But for, I'm talking about the mainland.
Okay.
And so basically what probably will be an exception will be Masbate and Catanduanes.
Okay. All right. But you believe that the Bicol region will deliver for Lenny?
The minimum probably would be at 80% of 4 million, that's 3.2. And from 3.2, I think she will at least get 2.7 million.
Okay.
That's assuming lower percentages, mm-hmm. like 60% in Masbate and 60% in Catanduanes.
Okay. So, well, you're clearly, you're a math guy, but the question is, why aren't the crowds, all this support, why isn't it reflecting in the surveys of Pulse Asia?
Well, right now, because although I'm not, how would you call it? It's just a sideshow, you know. And I've been telling the insiders in Lenny that, you know, you better get these people to campaign house to house in order to convert. But one thing about these rallies is that it's really showing to the rest of the nation that it's napupukaw po niya yung mga silent supporters, and they're not campaigning, they're not war board they are not computer board warriors. So basically, makikita mo doon is at least high conversion rate. I think in those engagement by Lenny, once they're touched, I think the likelihood that they will be converted is 80%. And number two, okay, is that there's very high voters energy or campaign energy within that particular group.
Okay. Now, recently, Malacañang has confirmed a meeting between President Duterte and former Senator Bongbong Marcos. Are you expecting Congressman Salceda for the president to directly endorse, outright endorse Mr. Marcos in this situation?
No, it's enough for me that he said that he wanted a compassionate lawyer. So I am essentially going by that. That is more essential for me. And what he said is that the consequence of that is I'm rooting for Attorney Robredo and Attorney Sara. Both are lawyers and both are compassionate.
So you really believe that in the end, Duterte will not come out with a direct endorsement on anyone? Or
yes.
Or by a long shot, are you hoping that he will say VP Leni is the candidate? It's a bit of a stretch, but who knows?
I think that's remote.
That's remote,
We will not anchor any campaign strategy on that basis. We'd rather, what we're seeing essentially is that we're crawling all over the place. And I think there's a lot of constituencies so that are just waiting to be tapped.
Okay. All right. Just very quickly, you did push for already a declaration of an economic emergency where the DTI said it's unnecessary, it's not yet time. The government has recently come out with its 10-point policy agenda for economic recovery. Congressman, it's a month and a half to go before elections. Are you seeing the 10-point recovery, honestly, as even a possibility in the next few months?
If you read EO 166, there is an acknowledgement. First, they ask for a pandemic flexibility bill, which is akin to Republic Act 10.10.1.2.1, which is patterned in the Albay model, so that the government can efficiently roll out emergency programs via natural disasters and calamities. And that would include, of course, exogenous shock from oil prices as well as pandemics. And if you look at their number 10, they use lessons learned from this pandemic to make society more resilient. Again, that is in effect an acknowledgement of the state of emergency. And that is, well, in this case, they're calling for Center of Disease Control and Virology. But if you read, you go by that kind of pandemic flexibility, yung bill kasi namin actually is a structural approach. Pag lumampas ka ng 80, tatanggalin yung train. Pero pag bumaba ka ng 80, tatanggalin yun. Pag bumaba ka ng 40, dadagdag kami ng excise tax ng 3 piso. Nawawala po yung ano yan kasi this bill has already been approved on second reading in the House. So, and we did that last November, even before this brouhaha. We wanted the bill on excise tax to be more flexible. So there will be automaticity with respect to the fluctuations in prices.
So are you optimistic that will the amendments will pass?
I think it's good. It's good economic policy. Kaso, nagsisimula sila doon sa suspension of excise tax, but they don't read through the entire thing. So, anyway, I think nahihirapan sila how to call for a special session in the midst of all this campaigning already. So, but you know, with Zoom and everything, that should have been easy. I still insist that should have been the way forward.
Okay, but then the problem really is the finance department, right? I mean, the executive, it's the finance department that's refusing.
Well, I am the direct committee that is a counterpart of the DOF. And there has been, I think, a consensus. I don't know of any congressman that is against that bill. Because it is structural in approach. Pag lumampas lang 80, ano meaning ng 80? That is the fourth-year average of the oil prices. And why 40? Why 40? Because that's also the low during the pandemic low. We came from 40 and went as high as 128. So we're setting up this trigger and it sets for a social stabilization fund. So pag lumalampas ka ng 80, mawawala yung VAT. ay wawala po yung excise tax. Pero yung naipon mo doon, okay, nung yun ay mababa, ay pwede pang gastos, pantustos po doon sa mga ayuda o mga relief na kailangan po ng mga tao na hindi okay directly na nakukonsumo, halimbawa mga gas.
All right. Well, Congressman Joey Salceda, we can talk about this at length at another time, but I want to thank you so much for joining me today on Head Start, sir. You take care.
Yes, thank you very much, Karen.